Hello everyone, and welcome to the CSS Security Mini Briefing, where we will present a short summary of what was released today, February 13th, 2024. My name is Josh Daniel, and I'm a risk manager in the customer service and support organization here at Microsoft. We're going to start this video with an overview of the release, and then we'll dive into a few of the vulnerabilities. Please note that the details of the vulnerabilities that we are covering in this video may change, and the authoritative location for information will always be the online content in the security update guide. Before I dig into the CVEs related to this release, I like to compare how this release looks to the previous 12 months. And with that, we've been averaging 73.77 vulnerabilities per month. This month, we have a total of 73 newly addressed CVEs as part of today's release. Next, we'll look at remote code execution vulnerabilities, where we've been averaging right around 26.5 per month. This month we have 30. Typically, remote code execution vulnerabilities are the ones that have the most risk. They would allow threat actors to install software and do other nefarious deeds. And this month we're at 30 new remote code execution vulnerabilities, and we've been averaging right around 27.5 over the past 13 months. Next, I'll talk about scoring, where Microsoft uses the Common Vulnerability Scoring System. This is a scale between 1 and 10 that allows software and hardware vendors to compare and contrast vulnerabilities on an industry standard scale. This month, the highest scored CVE comes in at 9.8 on that scale of 10. We've been averaging around 9.5, 9.65. When we look at the average score across the entire release, this month we come in at 7.72. We've been averaging right around 7.32 over the past 13 months. Now, I will point out that 7.72 is the highest that we've seen for an average CVSS score across the entire release since September of 2022, and the second highest score that I've seen over the past 5 years that I've been tracking these numbers. So what that means, now a CVSS score is a starting point when we talk about risk. It doesn't include things such as whether a vulnerability has been exploited, whether it is publicly disclosed. It doesn't include the impact such as remote code execution, elevation privilege, and doesn't include severity. But it is, like I said, a good starting point to be able to compare and contrast all different vulnerabilities, whether it's a Windows vulnerability versus an Office vulnerability versus an Exchange vulnerability versus an Azure vulnerability. We're able to put these all on the same scale and see how they track out. And so this month we have quite a few. We have 25 CVEs that come in at 8.8 or above. So a full one third of the release hits 8.8 or above on that scale of 10. So there's a lot of vulnerabilities in today's release that have a higher risk factor to them. There are no publicly disclosed vulnerabilities in today's set, and we've been averaging just under one over the past 13 months. And finally, we have two vulnerabilities that are known to be exploited out in the wild at the time of release, and we've been averaging just under two at 1.85 over the past 13 months. Now let's take a look at just this release. We've been averaging for the Windows products in the mid-40s for most of the Windows products. So it's a little bit lower for some of them. It depends on the specific product. As we can see, we're down into the low 30s for Windows 10 1607, but we're up at 44 for Windows Server 2022. So it depends a little bit on what specific product we're talking about, but we're right about in line, maybe a little bit lower on average for across all the Windows products. As we move up the chart, we get into Office and then into some products that we don't see every single month. With Office, we have 7 vulnerabilities. There's a vulnerability with Exchange we'll talk to in just a few minutes. Then we get into some developer tools such as ASP.NET, Visual Studio, Azure DevOps, .NET all have vulnerabilities that are being addressed this month. And Dynamics 365 has a handful of vulnerabilities that are being addressed this month as well. Okay, let's start looking at some of the vulnerabilities that were part of today's set. The first one I'll talk to is CVE 2024-21412. This is a security feature bypass vulnerability in the Internet Shortcut Files component of Windows. This is an important severity, privately disclosed. This one has exploitation detected at the time of release. So this is one of those two. This has a base score of 8.1 on a scale of 10. The attack vector is over the network. The attack complexity is low. Privileges required is none, and user interaction here is required. Now, one thing I will point out with this vulnerability is that an unauthenticated attacker could send a targeted user a specially crafted file that is designed to bypass security checks. However, there's no way an attacker would be able to do this on their own. They have to force a user to view that specially crafted file. Typically, the attacker would have to convince them to take action by clicking on that file link. So that there's no documented mitigations or workarounds for this vulnerability, but there is that user action required component that does present a little bit of a speed bump, if you will. As far as affected software, it's Windows 10 and 11, as well as Server 2019 and 2022. Next, I'll talk to CVE-2024-21351. This is another security feature bypass vulnerability, this time in Windows Smart Screen. This is rated as a moderate severity, privately disclosed, but we have detected exploitation out in the wild. This has a base score of 7.6. The attack vector is over the network. The attack complexity is low. No privileges are required, but user interaction is required to leverage this vulnerability. There are no documented mitigations or workarounds for this. As far as affected software, it's all versions of Windows that are in mainstream support, whether it's desktop 10 and 11 or Server 2016, 2019, or 2022. Now, one thing I will point out about this is that the vulnerability allows a malicious actor to inject code into Smart Screen and potentially gain code execution, but it still requires user interaction, still requires an unauthorized attacker convincing a user to open a malicious file. So there is that speed bump with this one as well. Next, we'll take a look at CVE-2024-21413. This is a critical remote code execution vulnerability, privately disclosed to Microsoft with no known exploits out in the wild. This has a base score of 9.8 on that scale of 10. The attack vector is over the network. The attack complexity is low. Privileges required is none, and user interaction here is also none. One thing I will point out about this is that in this vulnerability, the preview pane is an attack vector. So the user doesn't have to open the file, they just have to preview it within that preview pane of Outlook. As far as affected software, it's Office 2016 and 2019, Office Long-Term Servicing Channel 2021, and 365 Apps Enterprise. There are no documented mitigations or workarounds for this vulnerability. And the last vulnerability that I will talk to today is CVE-2024-21410. This is a critical elevation of privilege vulnerability, privately disclosed to Microsoft with no known exploits out in the wild. This has a base score of 9.8, again on that scale of 10. The attack vector is over the network. The attack complexity is low. No privileges are required and no user interaction is required to leverage this vulnerability. Now, this one's a little bit confusing here. We have three versions of Exchange that are listed as affected software: Exchange 2016's Cumulative Update 23, Exchange 2019 CU13, and Exchange 2019 CU14. Now, there's only an update that protects by default on Exchange 2019 Cumulative Update 14. So if you're installing the latest Cumulative Update, you are protected by default. If you're running on older versions of Exchange, specifically Exchange 2019 CU13 or 2016 CU23, you will need to run a script in order to protect your servers. So there's that extra step that has to be done with the two older versions of Exchange that are still in support. So if you're using the latest version of Exchange, which is 2019 CU14, if you install the Cumulative Update, you are protected by default. There's only actions to be taken if you're running one of these two older versions. There's no known workarounds for this vulnerability either. And if you're concerned whether you have enabled extended protection at some point in the past or not, there is an Exchange Server Health Checker script that can be run to give you that information to tell you whether extended protection for authentication has been enabled or not. If you want some more details on this, these links in the mitigation as well as more information can be found in the CVE article for this vulnerability. That's it for the vulnerabilities that I will cover in today's mini briefing video. If you are a Microsoft Premier or Unified Support customer and you want to attend the full briefing call where we will cover more content and are available to answer questions, you can either work with your Customer Support Account Manager or CSAM to sign you up, or you can sign yourself up in Services Hub, where you would log on to Services Hub, look in the newsletter section, and search for Security Briefing, and then select the region and language that's appropriate for you. All right, I want to thank everyone for joining me today, and I will talk to you all next month.